Now, we began last week looking at the Beatitudes, and you will recall that the Beatitudes proper, they run from chapter 5, verse 3 down through chapter 5, verse 10, and verses 11 and 12 are really an elaboration on or commentary on the eighth and final Beatitude that is there in verse 5. Now, I pointed out that verses 3 and 10 have this identical reward. For theirs is the kingdom of heaven, which marks verses 3 through 10. That's a literary unit. So we have 3 and 10, same identical reward, marks that as a unit. And it also suggests or indicates that everything between verses 3 and 10 likewise concerns the kingdom. In other words, the blessings of these intervening Beatitudes between verses 3 and 10, they are kingdom blessings. So he says, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. The intervening blessings, these are also kingdom blessings, and the subjects of those blessings, they are described by kingdom norms, by attitudes and characteristics typical of disciples, of kingdom participants. Now the fact the blessings in verses 3 and 10, those are present tense, and you have all of the other blessings, the intervening verses, the blessings there are in future tense. That's probably an indication that though the full blessedness of these Beatitudes, it awaits the consummation. That's why I did all that stuff on the kingdom the first week. It awaits the finalization, the consummation of the kingdom. But there's a foretaste of this ultimate fulfillment is in the consummation, but there's this foretaste that's presently available of these blessings, in that the kingdom was inaugurated or instituted or initiated with Christ's first coming. Now, last week we looked at the first two Beatitudes in verses 3 and 4. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. And I want to pick back up with the Beatitudes, and we'll look at Matthew chapter 5, verse 5. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. Now this Beatitude, this is an allusion to Psalm 37, verse 11, the first part of Psalm 37, verse 11, which reads, but the meek will inherit the earth. And it's earth, land, same word. But the meek will inherit the earth in Psalm 37, 11. And according to Hauck and Schultz in the Theological Dictionary of the New Testament, they say that the Hebrew word in Psalm 37, 11, that Hebrew word that is translated meek, they say it took on the predominant sense of one who feels that he is a servant in relation to God and who subjects himself to him quietly and without resistance. So you see a spirit and an attitude that is common in these early Beatitudes. And you can see in Psalm 37, which we know from the Dead Sea Scrolls, that psalm was recognized as messianic. It was seen as a messianic psalm in the first century. Well, you can see in that psalm that the meek one is the person who lives faithfully with trust in the Lord as the one who's in control. If you read Psalm 37, you see that this is the meek one. He lives faithfully with trust in the Lord as the one who is in control and who consequently is at peace in a world that can at times seem like it's upside down. So he has this trust and this quietness and this submission to God and is at peace in this world that can seem upside down. So when you look at that, when you take the clarification of meek that is provided from this allusion to Psalm 37, the meek in this beatitude, it describes those who live in complete dependence on and submission to God. There, in other words, there are those who have surrendered to God. They have surrendered to God, which of course includes embracing His Son. And as such, they will receive the blessings of the kingdom, which are here specified as they will inherit the earth. Now, we don't pause on that a lot because oftentimes we haven't grasped this notion of the kingdom being inaugurated and consummated with a new heavens and new earth. So we kind of scratch our heads about that. But what he's talking about here is that their future is eternal resurrection life on a new earth, a creation that has been heavenized so as to be the dwelling place of God and man. The New Testament scholar D.A. Carson, he notes in his commentary on Matthew, he says, entrance into the promised land ultimately became a pointer toward entrance into the new heaven and new earth. Earth is the same word as land. You see, so you see that idea that it functioned as a type. As God's people are coming into the land, that functioned as a type for a broader blessing of earth. And earth in the sense of the consummated kingdom, the new heavens and the new earth. Who receives this blessing? The disciples receive this blessing. They're going to inherit the earth. They are going to be participants, or they're going to dwell in that perfect divine utopia that God has in store. He says the consummation of the messianic kingdom. So see, to me, that's why it's so important to have this idea. I don't think you can understand not only the Sermon on the Mount, but many other things in the New Testament if you don't see how central this idea of the kingdom is. He says in chapter 5, verse 6, blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they shall be satisfied. Now, most first century Jews, they were familiar with real hunger and thirst. You know, it wasn't like, that's a rare thing. I can remember being hungry at some times in my life. We were very poor. And I can remember being hungry. But not like this. You see, not like this, that they understood this, whether from famines or because of assaults that had happened. People understood and had experienced real hunger and thirst. Even, see, painful craving of the body for food or drink. Just really something that was just deep, painful craving. So hunger and thirst, see, in that day and age, they were very powerful metaphors for intense longing. See, when you said that hunger and thirst to people who really understood true hunger and thirsting, well, that was powerful. So he describes here hunger and thirsting for righteousness. So hunger and thirst, they were these powerful metaphors for this intense longing. And Jesus says that those who crave righteousness, who crave righteousness, meaning disciples, because that is characteristic of them. We crave righteousness. And he says that those who crave righteousness will receive the kingdom blessing of having that craving satisfied. So those who crave righteousness will receive the blessing of having that craving satisfied. Carson says, these people hunger and thirst not only that they may be righteous, that they may be personally or practically righteous. He says, i.e., that they may wholly do God's will from the heart. That's what we want, right? That is what disciples long for. We want to be righteous people. We want to live like Jesus. So he says, the people hunger and thirst not only that they may be righteous, but that justice may be done everywhere. It's not simply hungering and thirsting for personal righteousness. Yes, we do that, but we also hunger and thirst for all righteousness. He says, all unrighteousness grieves them and makes them homesick for the new heaven and earth, the home of righteousness. That's what Peter calls it in 2 Peter 3:13, where righteousness dwells. You see, they long for that and will have that fulfilled. It's on that day. It's on that day when the kingdom is consummated that our sanctification, our journey toward Christ's likeness will be complete, and we will dwell on a redeemed earth in which all unrighteousness and all injustice have been eliminated. As Jesus said in his explanation of the parable of the wheat and the weeds in Matthew chapter 13, verses 38 through 43, when he returns, all causes of sin and all lawbreakers will be thrown into the fiery furnace. And then he says, then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. See, this is the idea. What is the ultimate fulfillment of this craving for righteousness? It is that state. It is where it's headed. But again, there is a now and a not yet aspect to the kingdom. We here and now, in this overlap of ages, in this time when the kingdom is a present reality but not yet a final manifestation, we experience a foretaste of this ultimate satisfaction of our craving for righteousness by the power of the Spirit. You and I, as kingdom participants, we put to death the misdeeds of the body. You see, we long for this Christ-likeness, this personal righteousness, which will ultimately be fulfilled when our sanctification is complete and we are fully Christ-like in that consummated kingdom. But here and now, the kingdom is a present reality. We have a foretaste of that, and that you and I, as kingdom participants, are by the power of the Spirit putting to death the misdeeds of the body. And I like this because it shows you that it is by the Spirit, but that we have a role to play. It is by the Spirit, who ultimately is the power who is transforming us, but there is a role for us to play. If by the Spirit you are putting to death, I have a yielding responsibility, that I yield and stop fighting and allow the Spirit to transform me. So even here and now, we have this foretaste of righteousness as kingdom participants. And even now, we abstain from sinful desires that war against our soul. As Peter says in 1 Peter 2:11, he calls us to abstain from sinful desires. We are not like the world. We do not live like the world here and now. We don't do that. We are being transformed into the image of Jesus. So even now, we are participating, having that longing for righteousness fulfilled in our personal lives, in practical righteousness. You see, and we live righteously before men, though not yet perfectly. But we live righteously before men, and as a result, some of those in contact with us glorify our Father in heaven, as he'll say in Matthew chapter 5, verse 16. And in the here and now, those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, we do what we can to influence the world for righteousness. See, it is not simply that our longing for righteousness is for personal transformation, that we may do the will of God from a pure heart. It is that, but we're all about all righteousness because we hunger and thirst for it. So we do what we can to influence the world for righteousness. We oppose every evil and injustice, wherever and by whomever it is committed. We oppose that, and we promote what is right and good. And if we are fortunate enough to live in a society that grants us a political voice in its direction, we exercise our stewardship of that privilege to move the society in the direction of righteousness. Why? Because we long for it. We hunger for it. And if we are given that privilege and that benefit, we have a stewardship of that. So what do we do as disciples? We use that privilege to try to move the world, our society, our culture, toward righteousness. We make our voices known that the murder of unborn children is wickedness. And we make our voices known that homosexual conduct and its glorification are sinful. And we make our voices known that oppression and the exploitation of the weak and the poor is immoral. And we make our voice known that all men and women should be judged by the content of their character and not by the color of their skin. I've heard that somewhere. But we make our voice known. Why? Because we are people who crave righteousness and justice. That's who we are. That's who we are as disciples of Christ. He says in chapter 5, verse 7, "Blessed are the merciful, for they shall receive mercy." This is the next kingdom norm or characteristic of disciples, is being merciful. Now, this includes forgiveness for the guilty, but it also includes compassion for the suffering and the needy. Forgiveness for the guilty, but also compassion for the suffering and the needy. We are the opposite, the antithesis of grudge-holding and cold-hearted people. That's not who we are. We're the opposite of that, of grudge-holding, cold-hearted people. The blessing given to Christians, those who are described here as the merciful, is to be shown mercy by God. Ooh, that's a blessing. To be shown mercy by God. See, this happens now. See, now and not yet. This happens now in God's ongoing forgiveness of our sins, as you see in 1 John chapter 1, verse 7. And it will happen in the future when God bestows His mercy on us at the final judgment, as indicated in 1 Timothy 1:18 and Jude verse 21. Conversely, those who refuse to show mercy, those who simply refuse to show mercy, they are not disciples of Christ and thus will not be shown mercy by God. As Jesus will make explicit in chapter 6, verses 14 and 15, and as James makes clear in James chapter 2, verse 13, if you refuse to show mercy, you're not a disciple of Christ. I don't care what you're telling me. And you will not, therefore, be shown mercy by God. And interesting to me, anyway, is that text in James chapter 2, verse 13, the failure to show mercy there in that particular text is there, it refers to their dishonoring of the poor man, doing that so as to favor the rich man. That is there referred to as a failure to show mercy to the poor man. And so this idea of refusing to show mercy is something that's very important. The story is told of John Wesley. Wesley was the 18th century founder of the Methodist movement. Wesley's sailing to America, and he heard a commotion in a cabin. And he went to see what was going on, and there was this famous man there named General Oglethorpe, and he was just berating this servant who had stolen from him, just going off on this guy. And he told Wesley, "The rascal should have taken care how he used me so, for I never forgive." And Wesley reportedly replied to him calmly, "Then, sir, I hope you never sin." All right, Matthew chapter 5, verse 8. "Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God." This is the next kingdom norm or characteristic of disciples, is being pure in heart. Now, this probably is an allusion to Psalm 24, verses 3 through 6. Which not only includes in the Greek translation the very phrase "pure in heart," but it also speaks of receiving a blessing from God, and it implies that they will see Him. So it's probably an allusion to that. He says, "Who shall ascend the hill of the Lord? And who shall stand in His holy place?" This idea of being right there with Him. "And who has clean hands and a pure heart?" Which in the, like I say, the Greek translation is "pure in heart." Very same phrase you get. "Who does not lift up his soul to what is false and does not swear deceitfully. He will receive blessing from the Lord and righteousness from the God of his salvation. Such is the generation of those who seek Him, who seek the face of the God of Jacob." So you probably have here an allusion to this. And the pure in heart are those who have an undivided heart, unadulterated, heart-level commitment to God and thus to the kingdom and to its righteousness. As he says in Matthew 6, 33, "Seek first kingdom and its righteousness." But those who have this undivided heart-level commitment to God, this inner, unadulterated devotion is the fountain of their behavior. It is this heart level, this undivided, this loyalty, this true devotion to God that is the fountain of how they act and what they do, unlike some Pharisees. Their righteousness isn't a put-on. It's not a mere outward show for onlookers. So it's not something that really expresses what I am inside. I'm more concerned about what you think of me, so I'm just doing something when you're watching me. That's not it. That's not who we are as disciples. It's something that comes from the inside out, and it is consistent even when no people are around. It's consistent even when there are no people around. They are genuine. They are the real deal. They are not phony. They are not hypocritical. They are not put on. They are not plastic. They are not posers. They are real. Inside, surrendered, devoted to the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what he's talking about. Now, that's not to say that Christians are already perfect in that area, that they don't struggle with divided loyalty. You know better than that. It's not that we don't struggle with it. It's to say that they refuse to accept it or to make peace with it, knowing that it undermines and it corrupts righteous living. When they wander, they are responsive to the Spirit's call as expressed in James chapter 4, verse 8, where he says, "Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded." You see, the idea is that they live or are centered in a genuine and a pure devotion. It's not that they don't get pulled and all this. They don't straddle and live in the world and in the church or in the kingdom. They don't do that. They are centered in a true devotion. And as they struggle, they heed the Spirit's call. No, this is who I am. This is what I'm doing. I'm loyal to Jesus. He saved me, gave his life for me, and I give my life for him. That's the idea. You see, there is a reality here that is inward, and it's very important. You see, the blessing given to Christians, those described here as pure in heart, he says, is to see God. See, now and not yet. Now, we do this figuratively with eyes of faith as we enter by the blood of Christ into the heavenly holy of holies, into the presence of God. As the writer of Hebrews indicates in Hebrews chapter 6, verse 19 and 20. And we also, as spirits in the heavenly realm, as disembodied spirits, between the time of our death and Christ's return, we will in some way perceive or be cognizant of God's presence. You can see that all over the book of Revelation, where you have spirits there who are, what, aware. And so that's true also. So we have now, by faith, as we enter into the heavenly, the Holy of Holies, in the disembodied state between, should we die before the Lord returns, we will be aware of, cognizant of God's presence. But the ultimate fulfillment of this blessing will be when? At the consummation. It will be when Christ returns, when we will, as resurrected people, see God in all his brilliance in the new heavens and new earth. As it says in Revelation chapter 21, verse 22 and 23, "And I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb, and the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and its lamp is the Lamb." And it says in Revelation 22, verses 3 and 4, "No longer will there be anything accursed." See, that goes back to the fall, back to Genesis. No longer. See, God, this is the whole story. God has been working to redeem the corrupted creation. And he says, no longer will there be anything accursed, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face. See, blessed are they. They will what? They will see God. We see God. Yes, I understand. We see God. There's a sense with eyes of faith. There's a sense we'll see God perceiving him as disembodied spirits in the intermediate state. But there is the fullest, ultimate sense of seeing God in the consummated kingdom. And as he says, they will see his face and his name will be on their foreheads. So Jesus is here in these Beatitudes again. He's teaching these things about these are kingdom norms, kingdom blessings. He says in chapter 5, verse 9, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called sons of God." Now, another kingdom norm or characteristic of disciples is that they are peacemakers. You see, rather than causing fueling, flaming, getting these things burning up, fanning the flames, rather than doing any causing, fueling, fanning, or enjoying hostility and alienation. Christians seek to make peace wherever possible. This is who we are as Christians. Paul writes in Colossians 1, 19 and 20, he says, "For in him all the fullness of God was pleased to dwell, and through him to what? Reconcile. To reconcile to himself all things, whether things in heaven or things on earth." What? Making peace. Well, that sounds like that's a quality of God. Making peace through the blood of his cross. Paul says in Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 13 to 18, he's speaking here of Jews and Gentiles and this divide, a huge social divide. And he says, "But now in Christ Jesus, you who at one time were far away have been brought near through the blood of Christ, for he is our peace, the one who made both groups one and broke down the dividing wall, which is the fence, having set aside in his flesh the hostility, the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, so that he might create in himself one new man out of the two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both to God in one body through the cross, having put to death in himself the hostility. And having come, he proclaimed peace to you, those who were far away, and peace to those who were near, for through him we both have access in one spirit to the Father." See, what's this thing about Christians and peacemaking? Well, do you see? Do you see who God is and what he's about and what he's doing? He is rescuing creation from alienation and fragmentation and division and hostility. He is reconciling, and ultimately, he brings all things together in the consummated kingdom, all through Jesus Christ. He ultimately does that all through Jesus Christ. See, as people who have experienced peace with God through his mercy given to us in Christ, and peace with one another across all human divides, Jew and Gentile, any race, any nation, any social class, all differences and distinctions like that are absorbed into the oneness of Christ. We are a family across all of those worldly divides. And so as people who've experienced that, we reflect that character of God in our interactions in the world. It shouldn't be surprising in the least. We are reconcilers. We are healers. We are the very opposite of fomenters of alienation. That's not who we are. We're not stirring the pot. We're not trying to divide people. We're peacemakers. We're reconcilers. We are healers. We thus seek to reconcile lost sinners to God through sharing the gospel. Right? We're about that. We're about reconciling lost sinners to God through sharing the gospel. We're about that. And we're about healing broken relationships in the world and in the church as we have opportunity. We seek peace here and now. Here and now, knowing that the true and ultimate peace awaits what? The consummation. Now, we pursue it. We seek it. We are peacemakers. We are reconcilers. We are healers. Why? This is the ultimate state. This is the heart of God, and you and I are disciples, and we are working, you see. It is though we are building, see, for this. And I've told a number of you this story. This is a side note here, footnote, but I just like it. N.T. Wright wrote a book, Surprised by Hope, where he talks about a lot of things. He basically laments how so many people in church have lost this idea of God's rescue of creation. And one of the things, he was being interviewed by Ben Witherington, who's another New Testament scholar, and Witherington was asking him, saying, "Look, I see this, you know, this glorious thing. Of course, this is, you know, longstanding. This is Christian theology of the new heaven, the redeemed creation, all that. But what's the connection between our living here and that? I know that we don't create the new heavens and new earth. That's God's work. Is there any connection?" And I just like the idea that Wright said, well, I look at it this way. He said it's like a medieval stonemason who's been just given this big block and he's been told to carve it. He has no idea how the architect of the cathedral will take that block up after he's finished and bring it into what he's building. And he said, I look at it that way. And that's how I look at it, in terms of being faithful and laboring and building. And I think there's something in what Paul says with this wood, hay, and stubble that comes through. And so you and I labor faithfully to build consistently with the eternal vision of God, and we leave to God the consummation and the construction, the redemption of creation. That's just a footnote. Okay. Now, this doesn't mean, this idea that we're peacemakers, this does not mean, of course, appeasing or compromising with evil for the sake of peace. We don't do that. Jesus knew that his uncompromising call to commitment, his demand that he be the disciples' highest priority, he understood that that would bring conflict even within families. He didn't say, you just go ahead then and sell out and do anything for the sake of peace. Not at all. See, he understood that. It's in that sense that he said in Matthew chapter 10, verse 34, that he didn't come to bring peace, but a sword. Yeah, I thought it's all about peace. He is about peace, but he's about peace in God's way. Not selling out the truth just to try to appease people so you can live in peace. He's not talking about that at all, you see. He didn't say allegiance to him should be abandoned for the sake of peace. We don't make something else Lord over him. But there's plenty of room, isn't there, for peacemaking that doesn't involve selling out, isn't there? I mean, I think I've been paying attention. I think there's plenty of room for peacemaking that doesn't involve selling out. Now, can you imagine how this quality of seeking healing and reconciliation and all this, how it would revolutionize our marriages and our churches? I think it would. I think if we really saw this, you see, it seems too often to be lacking. And yet Jesus, he takes it as a given of his followers, as he does with all these qualities. See, Christians, those who are characterized by peacemaking, are blessed in that they will be called, he says, sons of God. That's who they will be, what they'll be called. And we enjoy that special relationship with God here and now. Right? I mean, we're sons and daughters of God here and now. You can see, for example, Romans 8:15, receive the spirit of adoption. Galatians 3:26, all are sons of God through faith because you are sons. Hebrews 12, God is treating you as sons. So there is a sense, right, that is a present blessing that we enjoy. But there is still a sense in which our adoption as sons awaits the consummation. It awaits our resurrection at Christ's return. That's why Paul says in Romans chapter 8, verses 22 and 23, for we know that all the creation groans and experiences birth pains together until the present. And not only that, but even ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we ourselves also groan in ourselves while eagerly awaiting our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. See, there is some sense, you see, in which there is a fuller, more complete experience of the sonship that we presently enjoy in the resurrection state. Jesus says the same thing. He indicates the same thing in Luke chapter 20, verses 34 to 36. He says, the sons of this age marry and are given in marriage. But those who are considered worthy to attain to that age and to the resurrection from the dead neither marry nor are given in marriage, for they cannot die anymore. Why? Because they're resurrected. You remember in Romans 6:9? Jesus' resurrection. After his resurrection, what? Death no longer has mastery over him. Why? Because he's now resurrected. He was subject to death. He died. But as a resurrected person, death no longer has mastery over it. So he says here, they cannot die anymore because they are equal to angels and are sons of God, being sons of the resurrection. Okay, so I want you to, that's why there's this now and this not yet. Yes, we're sons and daughters of God. There's a sense, of course, in which that is true, and we rejoice in that. But there's this further sense in which we will be sons and daughters of God in some fuller, more complete, different way as resurrected beings, as resurrected people. He says in Matthew chapter 5, verse 10, "Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." Now, Jesus here describes Christians as those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. See, persecution comes with the territory. You know, you have to teach your kids this. Persecution comes with the territory. We're not trying to sell people Christianity. Hey, it's just a self-help program. Come in and you get stuff. Persecution comes with the territory. Well, we don't want to tell anybody that because it'll scare them off. Well, that's the truth. That's the truth. It comes, it's part and parcel of being a disciple of Christ, a kingdom participant in this overlap of ages. And that's why Paul wrote in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 12, "All who desire to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted." If you seek to emulate the life of the one the world crucified, what do you think's your lot? Do you think you're going to do it better than he did it? The world crucified him. Do you think there was reason? He was sinless. So anybody who wants to live godly in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. And the persecution is for righteousness' sake, because godly character and righteous living of disciples, that is a silent indictment against the sinful lifestyles of others. And that incites resentment and it inspires mistreatment. That's the dynamic of why. You know, why for righteousness' sake? Well, the dynamic is that it's convicting to people and it stokes them in their anger and then they attack you for it. And you see that dynamic noted in 1 Peter chapter 4, verses 3 and 4. He says, "For enough time has passed to have participated in the desire of the Gentiles, having traveled in licentiousness, lusts, instances of drunkenness, revelries, drinking parties, and detestable acts of idolatry, regarding which they are surprised by your not running with them into the same flood of debauchery, vilifying you." Why is that? Because they're over here and you abstain and you're over here as a light and they're saying, "I hate this guy." Why? For righteousness' sake. Because it is convicting to the world and that inspires mistreatment and incites resentment. Now the blessing in store for Christians, those whose righteous lives stir persecution, it's identical to what he said in verse 3. He says, "Theirs is the kingdom of heaven." See, and they enjoy the present blessings of life in the kingdom, and I talked about those. We have great blessings here and now, life in the kingdom. You know, all of the things that we share as brothers and sisters, all of these other blessings that he's talked about, the now aspect of all of those blessings, we have those, and we'll have the blessings of eternal glory in the new heavens and new earth. Now, I don't know how far I can get here. I heard that bell, but I'm going to keep talking until the second one rings. Matthew 5, 11, 12, he says, "Blessed are you." Now, see, he's going to elaborate on these things. He's got some other stuff to say. That concludes the Beatitudes proper, but he's now taking the sermon somewhere else. He's given kingdom norms and kingdom blessings, and he now says, "Blessed are you when others revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets who were before you." He elaborates here on that last beatitude that you get in verse 10, calling his disciples to rejoice in persecution rather than what? Rather than be intimidated by it. See, rather than be intimidated by it, rejoice in it. And he mentions three forms of hostility that his disciples will experience. He says, when? Not if. He says, when? They will be reviled or insulted. They will be persecuted, which covers all kinds of assaults on one's livelihood, property, liberty, body, and life, all of that. So they will be reviled or insulted, they will be persecuted, and they will be lied about, slandered. This doesn't seem like a very pretty picture. You see? But this is the truth of the matter. In verse 10, they are said to be persecuted for righteousness' sake. But here, the basis of the hostility, now it's broadened out to what? Because of me. Because of me. On account of me. And they, see, this includes persecution that's driven by hostility to Christians simply because they identify with and are loyal to Jesus. He here gives the deeper root of the persecution. Yes, there is persecution for righteousness' sake in that it convicts the world, which incites mistreatment and inspires mistreatment and incites resentment. Yes, that's true. Peter talked about it. But there's something deeper than that. There's something deeper than that. And it's on account of Christ. Jesus said in John 15, 18 to 20, if the world hates you, know that it has hated me before it hated you. So what do you think? Are you a disciple? Is he the master? Are you a disciple of the master and you're sitting here following the master? I want to learn and be and emulate and do everything like the master. Well, what happened to your master? They hated him. Well, what do you think they're going to do to you? They're going to hate you. If you were of the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. He told the disciples in Matthew chapter 10, verse 22, that they will be hated by all for his name's sake. And that's why the apostle John says in 1 John chapter 3, verse 13, do not be amazed, brothers, if the world hates you. Act like, well, this, what is this? Don't be amazed. If the world hates you, hostility and persecution need not mean the church is doing something wrong, as so many seem to think. They're eager to lay blame for the world's hostility at the church's feet, claiming it's a reaction to our being too narrow-minded or our being judgmental. But whatever ammunition we may have handed the world, the fact is that this is a spiritual war that is rooted in hatred of the Son of God. Paul says in Ephesians 6:12, for our struggle is not against blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the world-controlling powers of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. This is what's at play. This is what is going on. You see, if we were flawless, if we were fully like Christ, as we will be in the consummation, they would still hate us because they hate our Lord. You have to see that. You have to see that. You see, Jesus says in chapter Matthew 5, verse 11 and 12, that in response to this type of mistreatment, Christians should rejoice and be glad. And the reason we should have that response, the reason we should rejoice and be glad, is that a great reward is in store. A reward that is kept in the security of heaven so that no power can take it. That's what they kept in heaven. Nothing can touch it. No power is going to sneak in and someday you're going to say, ah, you thought it was there, but I took it. No. This reward is kept in the security of heaven. We cannot be deprived of it. And just as the prophets will be rewarded for faithfulness to God, I heard that, let me just finish this. Just as the prophets will be rewarded for faithfulness to God, despite all that they endured. Right? You look in Hebrews 11. What did the prophets endure for faithfulness to God when the world would have been saying, what are you, crazy? Abandon ship. Leave him alone. They endured all that. And everybody understood that because of their faithfulness under fire, that they were going to have a great reward, and that's what he's telling them. See, between that they're going to have this great reward, and between their death and Christ's return, they will be at home with the Lord as disembodied spirits, which Paul says in Philippians 1:23 is what? Better than this life by far. Okay? So the intermediate state is better than this life by far, but ultimately, They will experience the glory of full-bodied resurrection life in the new heavens and new earth when Jesus returns to finish what he started. Now, that's a reward. That's a reward, you see. They will have that. And that's what he's saying. You rejoice rather than be intimidated by it, because a great reward is in store for faithfulness. You hold on to that. Thanks for coming.